Good morning. There we go. How's everybody doing this morning? I'm a little worried about some of y'all. Did we all shower this morning or something? We're all spread out or something. I don't know. It just looks weird. I did, okay? So you don't have to be worried about me. Some of you are worried about me for other reasons. That's okay. How are we this morning? There we go. Is it good to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Good morning to everybody viewing on Facebook. If you're up in the worship center, good morning to you. We are glad that you have joined us today. Let's talk about our mission statement. What do you think? Can we do that? Is it good to remember our mission?
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay, amen. Who are we?
Crossroad Baptist
Church. And why do we exist? Because of Jesus Christ and for His glory. To what end? Some of y'all are watermelon. I caught you. To love God completely, to love others sincerely, and to make disciples continually. And to all of those program directors, leaders who have turned in your ministry vision plans, thank you so much for doing that. And we're excited to see what God's going to do with those things. We got a special Sunday next Sunday. Want to make sure to make mention of so that you're prepared to join us next Sunday. We're going to have a guest. Walker Armstrong is going to be here, and he's going to be talking about discipleship for the entire morning. And so what that's going to look like is at 9 o'clock for our middle school Sunday school classes all the way up, okay? So everybody younger than middle school will have your normal Sunday school class, but for everyone else, we will be in our CLC at 9 a.m., and we will be live streaming that. So if you're watching online, feel free to join us next Sunday at 9 a.m., Also, we'll be in our worship center if anybody wants to have the mask on up in the worship center for the 9 a.m. Talk with Walker Armstrong. We'll have that available as well. And then at 10 a.m., he will be preaching for our worship service, and that will also be in here and in our worship center and streamed live online as well. So we hope that you'll plan to join us for that. We're looking forward for God to do some awesome stuff that Sunday. Also want to make mention to you, we have a Region 5 disaster relief training that is available to anyone that is interested. If you have your trifold bulletin, there's a whole big long announcement with all kinds of information about that, so I'm going to let you read that. But the dates for that disaster relief training are March 11th and the 13th. The 11th is a virtual meeting, and the 13th is in person. And that will be at Southside in Greensboro. So if you're interested in that, check out that information in your bulletin to see how you can get signed up for that. Cost is $30, I believe. And then also want to mention to you one more time that on March the 24th, that Wednesday night, the Awanas will be having their Grand Prix, their race car race. And so if your student would like to participate in that Awana Grand Prix, be sure to get their supplies for their cars Wednesday night in Awanas. All right, so those are all the announcements I have for you this morning, so let's jump into worship. What do you say, Pastor Mitch? Sound like a good idea?
Would you stand? Let's pray together. Father God, we love you. We thank you for your presence in this place. We thank you for your goodness, your mercy, your grace, for having the name that is above every name, for allowing us the privilege of lifting up Jesus in this place today. No matter where we find ourselves, Lord, we can lift you up and worship your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
There's just something about Him fills my heart with joy. There's just something about His name. Only one that I worship, only one I adore, only one my heart will praise. There's just something about His name. Jesus, lift up Jesus, sing the name that o'er. song in the night. He's been faithful all my days. There's just something about His name. So Jesus, lift up Jesus. Sing the name that overcomes. Savior, He has freed us. Lift up Jesus, lift Him up. Holy, holy, over this field in His glory. Holy, holy, worthy of praise. Holy, holy, all the saints are singing His glory. Holy, holy, no other name. Holy, holy, all earth is filled with His glory. Holy, holy, worthy of praise. Holy, holy, all the saints are singing His glory. Holy, holy, no other name. Jesus, lift up Jesus, sing the name.
So encouraged by that song, because that word overcome, because no matter what I face, no matter what I come up against, no matter what comes up against me, He can and will and has overcome. Amen. And that's good to know. It makes you feel good knowing that you can stand up against anything as long as you got Jesus on your side.
Let praise be a weapon that silences the enemy. Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing Your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all we are and proclaim Your victory. freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. For fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of praise is on our side. Forever lift your heart. And all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, 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 oh. We praise you. Oh, 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 oh. We praise you. Oh, 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 oh. We praise you.
Commands my destiny. No power of hell, no sin.
You may be seated. As we enter into this time of giving this morning, our youth praise band is going to join us and share a song that they've been doing in worship in their time of worship on Wednesday nights. And we're grateful for them coming and sharing this morning. And there's a couple of older youth in the group. Just ignore us. Sorry about that. It's always good to be in the house of the Lord and have the opportunity to give because he has given us so much. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you and we praise you for this opportunity, another opportunity to worship you and to give of ourselves as living sacrifices, and also to give of the resources that you have blessed us with, Lord, to give tithes and offerings, knowing that you're going to use them in ways that perhaps we'll never be aware of to build your kingdom. Lord, use us also to help build your kingdom as you show us the opportunities before us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning to everyone. Let's take our Bibles to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, and we'll be there in just a moment. February is Discipleship Month, and we're getting towards the end of it. Next Sunday is the final Sunday in February, and I want to call that our Discipleship Sunday next week on the 28th of February. And you have your schedule in the bulletin for that special day and already been announced. I've invited Walker Armstrong to be our guest speaker here next week at 9 o'clock. Now, I want you to come early. If you normally don't come to Sunday school, plan on coming an hour early and meet us in here and or up in the sanctuary at 9 o'clock next coming Sunday morning. And then for the main service, the preaching service at 11 o'clock. Walker was born and raised here in Asheboro. I've heard his testimony many times. And he came to know Christ as an 18-year-old teenager. And Stan Haywood met him and discipled him personally at his store every Friday evening. He and another teenage young man. I think the other fellow was a year older than Walker. And Walker now is in full-time ministry with Discipleship. He's the director of missions, executive director over in Pilot Mountain Association. But our special guest next week, I'm hoping God will use his testimony as to what God can do through a teenage young man who comes to know Christ and comes to know Christ even better. And so we'll hear him speak on next week. Before we get into 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, I want to take part of my time this morning and just give you a testimony of the journey that I've been on in discipleship in my personal life, and then we'll conclude just a few minutes, three simple thoughts out of 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. Just kind of keep in mind there's three levels of discipleship, actually more, but to keep it simple, three levels of discipleship. I believe in corporate discipleship. That means in groups and coming together in masses of people or groups of people that can be discipled, especially through the church. I believe discipleship is taking place this morning here in this gymnasium. Whether you're receiving it or not is up to you, but the discipleship is being had in this service this morning. 9 o'clock, I was Sunday school teachers. They're teachers, and they teach to learners. And there's a level of discipleship taking place in Sunday school every Sunday morning. And on Wednesday nights across these buildings, it's kind of like a discipleship setting here. And a teaching session from our children from 2 years age and up in our Awanas and in our youth ministry and our adult ministry. It's a teaching time. And you could be discipled in corporate settings such as that. And then you can have some discipleship by way of influence, just watching people's lives. Though they never sit down and teach you the scriptures personally, a life lived showing you the gospel and showing you the way of Christ and how to live for Christ is an awesome use of discipleship by way of being an influence on a person's life. Many of you have had such parents that influence you to the ways of the Bible and the ways of God and have nurtured your faith by their influence, a close relationship through them. But I want to go one level a little further this morning if I can, and there's probably several levels in between, and that's personal discipleship. That's somebody just one-on-one with you that nurtures your faith, or one-on-one, you're the disciple maker and you're helping them in discipleship and teaching them the Bible, and you have a purpose for your conversation. And while you are teaching and talking to them, they are being nurtured in their faith to grow like Jesus. Sometimes they come to a place of decision that they want to make because they've heard something. They've been influenced about something about the Bible, about the gospel. Last week's message will, if you review that, you'll see what discipleship does for us by way of teaching us and correcting us and sending us and so forth. And so there's personal discipleship. That's kind of what we're talking about here in our church. When we talk about discipleship ministry, what we would like to see is our people personally, not only having a desire, But making a decision to help somebody with the gospel and to bring them along and nurture them in the faith. I've said this often since I've been here. There's three groups of discipleship in our church today. One is a group of people who've not known personal discipleship. They've had corporate discipleship and influential discipleship, but they've never yet been personally discipled by a friend or a lover, someone who loved them and cared for them to bring them up in the ways of the Lord by teaching them the scriptures and teaching the ways of Jesus. They've never been personally discipled and being a student of someone who's teaching them, a learner of a teacher who's teaching them the Word of God. And then there's others that have been discipled. You can say, man, I'll tell you who discipled me. And I don't mean influence like a parent or a friend or someone that I like in church, but they personally, on a Saturday or a Monday or during the weeks, had it was just kind of an ordered time. We would get together and they would sit down. The only purpose for getting together was for me to be discipled and listen to what they had to say. And so there's people who've never been discipled personally. There are some people who have been discipled personally. And there's another group. There are people right now who are discipling somebody personally. You know their name. You know when you meet. You know what you're teaching them. You know where you are right now in discipling that person. Now, that'd be very, very smaller number than the first two circles of people who've not been discipled or have been discipled. But we're talking about active disciple makers at Crossroad Baptist Church. Wouldn't it be something that really fits in the flesh the mission of this church, that mission statement in your bulletin that you quoted this morning a little earlier? Wouldn't it be something if that could be realized in the next few months at our church, that people have not only had the desire, not only made the decision, but they're actively got somebody on the hook that they've decided they're going to nurture in their faith and help them to grow and to go in the Word of God on a personal level, without the church organizing it or anything like that, just that it's happening, going to be a disciple maker. And to think of the prospect of having 5 or 10, and could it be even 15 people in our church will become disciple makers out of this congregation, out of 400 and some members. To think about it, just 15, just 3 or 4% of the people saying, yep, I believe God would have me, if I read my Bible right, God wants me to disciple somebody in the faith personally. Not just be assigned to a Sunday school class or an Awana class or a youth class, but I mean, I'm personally signed up and ready to go, and God has given me someone who's listening one-on-one to the words of the gospel. I got saved when I was 6 years of age, and I was baptized about 6 months thereafter as a little child. My dad was a deacon in the church, just a young man. But I can say that my dad allowed me to be corporately discipled. We never missed Sunday school. Back then we had RAs and we had training union. How many remember training union on Sunday nights? We had Sunday morning service, Sunday night and Wednesday night. And it was just constantly going to church back when I was a little boy. I was corporately discipled. I've been influentially discipled. Many people have influenced me to follow Jesus, and I'm thankful for all those people. But I was personally discipled by my dad. Now, he could have just influenced me and lived a good life and take me to church, that stuff. But let me tell you what my dad did. 5 days a week, he discipled me. 5 days a week, he'd say, come on in here in the living room. Come around the dining room table. We're going to sit down and read and study the Bible and pray together. My dad discipled me from when I was 6 years of age to the day I went off to Bible college in Chattanooga, Tennessee, when I was 17 years of age. The last day of high school was my first day in college. I didn't even go to my high school graduation. I had to be at college on campus in June, early that year, 1973. But the last day that I was in high school, my dad had already gone to the office of the church to work, but my mother, you know what she did? She said, come on in here to the living room. Come on in here to the dining room table, just like they had for many, many, many years, every day before school and all in the summer 5 days a week, they would sit me down and read the Bible and talk about the Bible and disciple me. They didn't influence me only. They didn't take me to church only, but they personally sat down. We had what we called back then the family altar. Anybody heard that name before, the family altar? That's where the family gets together and has Bible study. We used to do that. Now you don't do that at home, but maybe you should, but most of us aren't doing that at home. Sitting down. And you know what? After 17 years of that, or 12 years of that especially, and going from college, I had this notion that's what you're supposed to do in the family. And so I get up on campus, and I'm looking for a girlfriend and thinking maybe someday I'll get married. And I'm thinking, you know what? I want to find a girl who wants to have family altar with me. I want to marry a girl who wants to read the Bible with me, and I can teach her and she can teach me. I want something we can pray together intentionally. And if God ever gives us kids, I was stupid. You know the idea I had? I said, when I get us some kids, we get us some kids. You know, we're going to do what Daddy did and Mommy did. We're going to sit down Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. Come on in here to the kitchen table. Come on in here to the couch. I would have said put down them devices, but we didn't have devices back in those days. Come on in here and listen to what I'm going to teach you today. And we did more in our family more than just read the Bible, which is a wonderful place to start. We would talk about the Bible. Daddy had five boys and five teenagers in his family at one time. And to think Daddy said, tell us how to be young. Man, he'd teach us and show us, and he would disciple. And I had this crazy idea. Boy, you know, that's what I need to do. That's what we need to do. And so I discipled my children like that. Sharon and I discipled our children like that. We taught them the Scriptures. And our children continue that on many levels as well. To think being personally discipled, I want to say this morning, I was discipled intentionally, personally by my father in a real living way. More than influence, more than just talking about it. We sat down and studied the Scriptures together, and he nurtured me in my faith. Well, I've had other people in my life that discipled me, and I'm thankful for them. But when I was 14 years of age, God had the idea of wanting to call me to be a preacher, like it was some business that he had of my life as a teenager. God can do what he wants with me. Well, I yielded that call, and I changed all my plans in a ninth grade boy, and I marked off the colleges I shouldn't be going to because that's not where you learn how to be a preacher, at these colleges. And I began thinking, God's going to use me to be a preacher, but I better get myself ready for this. I preached 3 days after my call to preach. February the 2nd, I was called. February the 5th, I was preaching to a household of teenagers in our church. We developed a youth gospel team in our church, and I can talk about that all morning, what God did through that. And one day we went down to Montgomery, Alabama, on a Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and I preached on a Friday night. Two young men came down the altar that night and got right with God. One of them was 2 years older than me, and the other was about a year older than me. They both got right that night. I don't have time for this story, but we became dearest of friends. He lived 50 miles from me. I'm 15, and he's 17 and a half years of age. But somehow we just got to know each other and love each other. And I'd have him come spend the night at my house. I'd go down to Montgomery, spend the night with his mom and dad in their house down there and get to know their church and so forth. We became dear friends. Well, the next year I become 16 years of age. I just got my driver's license in November of 72. And I had just turned 16 that year. I was always the youngest one in my class. And my brothers were up at Tennessee Temple University in Chattanooga. And on campus every year at the Highland Park Baptist Church during the midweek, between December, Christmas, and New Year's, they'd have a big winter retreat for young people. And I invited my best friend to go with me. He was already in college on a scholarship in Montgomery. And I said, why don't you ride up there with me? So I just got my license and drove 200 miles up to Chattanooga, and we went to this winter retreat, and the young man that I had with me, first time I'd ever been on campus too, man, God spoke to his heart in a big way. He was moved of God. He's on this Christian campus. He'd never seen a Christian campus in his life. And what he does, he goes to the registrar's office and he signs up a college to come back in 2 weeks and start classes in January right after the New Year's. He gets on campus for 2 weeks, and God knocked on his heart door and said, hey, boy, I want you to be a preacher. And he surrendered to be a preacher. He finished 4 years of college there, and I'm not even up on campus yet. And to this very day, my wife knows, best friend I've got, Jerry Walls, one of the best friends I have. Got several of them. And Jerry pastors in Warner Robins today, a church of 6,000 people. He took a church when it only had a couple hundred people. And God's blessed him over 20-some years now. And before COVID, their attendance was 3,500 to 4,000 people faithful every Sunday. And Jerry always talks about that. Tommy Lockwood, born in Alabama, a kid younger than me, came to my church, Temple Baptist Church, Montgomery. I got right with God. But I personally discipled Jerry as a teenage boy. So I know something about discipling people personally. When I pastored in Florida, I was a pastor who discipled people personally. Frank Annette is one man that comes to mind. I'm not going to give that story. My wife knows that story. There's others I can name to you that I just personally just took time. Not in a corporate way, although that was inclusive, not only an influence, but I would personally sit down with a new convert. He was 40 years of age at the time. And I can say, if you ask that man today up in New York City, who discipled you, he'd mention my name. Personally discipled. I moved up here to North Carolina. I met a guy who wasn't even in my church. And I was in a meeting one time, and he knew I was a pastor, and I talked about the gospel, and he was Catholic, and he called me one day, broken, and said, "Preacher, I need to talk with you." And we developed a wonderful relationship. One time he asked me to do some bow hunting with him. We took a trip up to Ohio, and all it was a discipleship trip, I guarantee you. We're in that car driving, we're hunting together, staying in the same hotel room, drive back. And I spent 5 days discipling Jeff Gehry. And if you can meet him today, he's just a layman on fire. He's a mortgage lender of all people. And I've taken time. I know what it is to personally disciple someone. I know the call. I know the blessing of it. And I want you to experience that. Let's look quickly in closing this morning in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 about the mission of discipleship. Three simple thoughts in this text this morning about the declaration of the gospel. That's what it is. It's not only proclaiming it, but it's also explaining it. I've heard a lot of preaching. Some would call it good preaching, where they just proclaim the gospel, but I didn't understand a word they were saying. They wouldn't explain the text to me. I've known guys that are just so educated and know the scriptures so well, and they're gifted in knowing the scriptures, but they lack in being able to explain the scriptures clearly to me. I like the proclamation of the gospel and the explanation of the gospel. That's important. To me, that makes good preaching. It makes good teaching. It makes a good disciple maker. If you could sit down and read scripture and teach someone the scriptures and explain it to them, that's what they did in Nehemiah, the scripture says. The Levites would get up and they just read the Old Testament, the Levitical laws. And then the scripture says that they caused them to have the sense and the understanding of the reading. You see, they explained and expounded the scripture so people could understand what the Bible says. That's disciple making to me. And I'm thankful for people that are good at this and intentionally have a purpose of taking the mission of the gospel or the word of God, not only to proclaim it to me, but to explain it to me. And there's some good thoughts behind that. But first of all, I want you to see in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, he says, For yourselves know, brethren, that our coming to you was not in vain. But after we had already suffered and been ministered in Philippi, as you know, we had boldness in our God to speak to you the gospel of God amid much opposition. The task of the mission is simply this: speak the gospel of God. Declare the gospel of God. Pastor, I've got a desire to be a disciple maker, and if I make that decision, what am I going to do? In a nutshell, here it is. You are going to speak the gospel of God. It's going to come out of your mouth. That's not normal conversation that people have. I listen in at the tables at the restaurant, you know, I'm standing in line someplace. I just don't hear much of that. I even hang around a church in the hallway. I don't hear much of that. I might even sit in a Sunday school class every now and then. I just don't even hear that either, you see. But the world of a disciple maker, I hear sermons preached. I don't hear much of that, is to speak the gospel of God. That's simple. Speak the gospel of God. And so when you decide to be a disciple maker, that's what you're deciding. I am deciding to speak the word, the gospel of God. It says it clearly in verse number 2. And so the mission is to declare the gospel of God. I don't want to expound on this, but let's just keep it real simple. Let's just imagine the gospel being only and concisely the death and the burial and the resurrection of Christ. I believe the whole counsel of God, the gospel, is all of the Bible. And any page you turn to, you're parked right on the gospel itself. And usually we think it's limited just to, but let's just say that it is limited to the death and the burial and the resurrection of Christ Jesus. Then that's what you're going to talk about. That's probably a good starting place, is to unfold about the life of Christ, the life of Jesus. And so you're going to speak the gospel of God. The task of the mission of discipleship is this: speak the gospel of God. Okay? Get your pen out, underline that, go back to that place. That's my task. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 2. Now, that's not the only place you'll see this. But you go through Titus. I went through the whole book of Titus last night. I read 1 Timothy chapter 1 and 2. I read all three of those pastoral epistles last night all the way through. And it talks much about speaking and talking and preaching and declaring. And in relation to what Paul says to his pastoral students, he says, you know, this is what you're going to do in ministry. But the application is the same for us as disciple makers. You're going to, Jesus, I'm going to go and I'm going to send you. And you're going to tell people. You're going to preach to people. You're going to teach people. So you're going to declare the gospel of God. Now, that's part of the decision you're making. You say, I'm not sure what it's all about. Well, just surrendering myself. I'm willing to be a disciple maker. Then just know, if you want to know something of the what, it's that simple task. Your mission is to declare the good news that's centered in the life and death and burial of Jesus Christ. It's all centered around that. That's not too difficult. That just kind of puts it in a nutshell for us. It puts on layman's term, is people that are disciple makers, people that disciple you, they are sharing and teaching and speaking about Christ and the gospel and your relationship and your fellowship with Him. And more of it is so needed. Matter of fact, it would probably help more people if you would personally do that with them than giving them Facebook churches they can go look at and hear some sermon or some podcast, or give them devotional booklets and so forth. If you would personally speak the gospel of God to people, it will probably root deeper and seed quicker when you personally do that. I wonder how many of us got saved not by going to church and hearing a sermon, though back in the 60s and 70s, that was quite common to go to church, be under conviction, and walk an aisle. But you were saved at the house. You were saved at work. Someone had been speaking to you the gospel of Jesus. And so the mission is to declare the gospel of the Lord Jesus. The motivation is one word in verses 3 through 12. It's the word love. You've got the what, I'm speaking the gospel of God. Then you got the why, because you love people. If you've taken that second phrase after the glory of God in our statement of because of God's glory, the glory of Jesus Christ, for God's glory and because of Jesus Christ, the second phrase, love God completely, but to love others sincerely. The motivation to perform your mission is out of love. Love people, whoever they are, whatever they are. Doesn't matter. You're determined because, listen, we love because God first loved us. His love's been shed abroad in our hearts. And as a believer in Christ, that love begins to spread. So the motivation is love. Look at verse number 3 of chapter 2. Our exhortation, when we spoke to you, our exhortation doesn't come from error or impurity or by the way of deceit, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak. You remember verse number 2? You're going to speak the gospel of God. So we speak, not as pleasing men, but God who examines our hearts. And then he tries to make the ground clear of understanding for those that would listen and speak. He said, first of all, notice, this is our motivation. We know God's mission is to declare the good news, but the motivation for the mission is actually loving people. It's not impure. He said our appeal didn't come from error or impurity or deception or to please you. It didn't come by flattery. He keeps on saying it didn't come by flattery or for greed. We didn't seek glory from men, verse number 6, either from you or others, even as apostles of Christ that have might asserted our authority. But we proved to be gentle among you as a nursing mother tenderly cares for her own children. He begins to show them the love. Oh, by the way, let's go in reverse just for a minute. I skipped over something here. Can you believe God did something for us? Look up this way. Can you believe that God entrusted you with the gospel? God entrusted you with the gospel. And you've got it. What you going to do with that entrusted gospel that you have? What do you suppose in this text the Lord wants you to do with that entrusted gospel that you have? You think he wants you to be silent, or does he want you to speak it? Does he want you to hide it, or does he want you to show it? Does he want you to keep it for yourself or your own glory, or does he want you to share it with others? He's entrusted me with the gospel, and I've got a sneaky suspicion. I could be wrong. I hope I'm wrong, but I got a suspicion. I got a spiritual suspicion. One day, Jesus is going to ask me, son, what you do with the gospel that I entrusted to you? How would you answer? How would I answer? Now let's go back forward again. The motivation of our mission is love. It's not for personal, people-pleasing, flattery, greed, self-glory. But the motive for doing the Lord's work should not be self-serving. It's not just meeting a benevolent need. The right motivation is derived out of love. And he said, I had such an affection for you. I felt like I was nursing you. Little baby gets the nurture from mama's milk. Mama's holding that baby and rubbing that baby's little head and wrapping that little baby and taking such care and protection for that little infant. Paul said, as young babies in Christ, he said, I treated you like my little baby, nurturing you and feeding you and helping you to grow. It was an affection like a nursing mother. In verse number 7. And then he goes a little further, and he said that it was motivated by God's love that was given to us. Look at verse number 9. He said, you recall, brethren, our labor and hardship, how working night and day, so as not to be a burden to any of you, we proclaim, there it is again, you're speaking at verse number 2. You're speaking at verse 5 or 6, it says. And here you are now, you're proclaiming it to you, the gospel of God. You're witnesses, and so is God, how devoutly and uprightly and blamelessly we behave toward you as believers, and me, your disciple maker. Just as you know how we were exhorting and encouraging and imploring each one of you as a father would his own children. Like a nursing mother, verse 8. And like a loving father with his own children. See that love? So that you would walk in a manner worthy of the God who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. You see his mission there? The mission is to share the gospel. That's this task. His motivation is as a loving father, as a nursing mother, so that I can help you to walk in your life in a way that's pleasing to the glory of God, our Father. He has such a love for his disciples and for his children in the faith and people that are following his example and listening to his exhorted words. And he displays that in love. And by the way, people will know your motives when you start flapping a Bible around them, you know, and asking of their attention to sit down and listen intently as you teach. And if there's anything that has to do with self, it'll be spotted in a heartbeat. They're smarter than that. But I want to tell you something. If you display the love of Christ when you go gently with encouraging words, people will listen and that seed will sprout further and quicker and the roots go deeper. And before you know it, you're going to have a tree bearing wonderful fruit. You're going to see branches that are part of the vine attached to the Lord Jesus Christ. And their fruit will remain by a disciple maker who handles people in love. And then closing, look at verse 13 and we're done. Here's the fruit of the mission. We've talked about the task of the mission. Simple. Teach the gospel. Talk about the gospel. The motivation is a mission of love. To do God's work. To help people. To walk in all manner of life that's pleasing to the Lord. Verse number 12. And here's their fruit in verse 13. For this reason. Now remember, by the way, I left out just one thing I want to remind you of. You remember how he talked about he labored day and night to proclaim and to preach and to nurture them as a mother, a nursing mother, and as a father to help them to walk the right path. It's sacrificial to be a disciple maker. Now, you need to think about that before you decide it's sacrificial. For Paul, it was day and night. I'm thinking 1 hour a week. If I be a disciple maker, I want to sit down with someone 1 hour a week. That's kind of standard. 1 hour a week. Paul said it for me. I labored and I worked and I helped and I found myself day and night. Being a disciple maker is sacrificial. It's hard work. It takes time. It's a selfless life giving to people who need the gospel. And then lastly, the fruit of the mission is somebody receiving and being receptive of this life-giving word of God. For this reason, we also constantly thank God when you received the word of God. You got it. That's my purpose in life. That's why we exist. To make disciples, to glorify Jesus, to love people sincerely, love God wholly. Man, it put the Mary in the heart. Well, I found it works just like it said it would. They received the word of God from you. Convicting question. Anybody going to be in heaven when they greet you on the other side of the gate and said, that person gave me the word. That person labored with me. They spoke the gospel to me. I know salvation is only in Christ. But it was fertilized by somebody speaking that word and explaining it to me. I received the word of God because of that disciple maker over there. Anybody on your list today? Are you still at zero? You've been saved how long? Isn't that convicting? I think it's probably the most convicting question you could ever ask me, John. How many people have you led to Christ? Oh, how I love Jesus. Go to church, read the Bible, wrote your check this morning. Man, you check all that good stuff off, and all the while you miss the main thing, is getting people to hear the word of God out of your lips so that they might hear and have the opportunity to receive the gospel and go with you. Oh, man, we ought to, every one of us, decide. I hope that you will. I'm going to be a disciple maker. From now on, today is the day that I'm signing up. I want to be a disciple maker. And so he says, this is the reason. We constantly kept talking to you about Jesus and giving, speaking the word, that when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it not as the word of men, but for what it really is. The word of God, which also performs its work in you who believe. You received it, you accepted it, and the word of God is working in you because I spoke to you. I spoke to you. God used me. When he asked of me and called me, he didn't ask me nothing. When he commissioned me and commanded me to go to all the world and preach, God used me that you might receive and accept, hear, accept and receive, and have the word of God working for you. Disciple making is probably the greatest thing you could ever be for the glory of Jesus, is to get people to follow you into God's kingdom in heaven. They continued gladly to hear and to learn God's word and to share it with others. I want to make a declaration this morning. I'm as serious as the lunch you're about to eat. Here it is. Next Sunday morning, 7 days from now, it not only is discipleship day, but I want it to be decision day. Would you allow me to do that as your pastor this morning? Can I open the doors for whoever decides to say, next Sunday, I don't know the how, I don't know all of the what, I don't know all of the where, but I do know this. God has been speaking to me these last few weeks about being more serious about sharing and speaking and giving the gospel to people all around me. I don't know what that means. I don't know what it looks like. One thing I do know is I'm willing. And there's your decision right there. Are you willing to speak the gospel? That's the mission. That's the task of the mission. Are you willing to speak the gospel of God to people personally? You have to decide what are the barriers, what are the reasons if I'm not. If you don't have the courage, pray God gives you the courage. If you don't have the boldness, pray God will give you that boldness. God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above anything you could ask or think. And to think you could never be a disciple maker is the biggest lie Satan can give to you this morning. So next Sunday morning, our invitation time, we're going to ask you to step forward. We want to see who you are. We want you to let this congregation know that you have made that decision. It'll help us further in our planning, what needs to be done, how the church can help. And it would be good if we had numbers of people just step forward. Don't have all the blanks filled in. We're not asking for that. But one thing for sure is you believe that God would have you to speak the gospel to someone. And I promise you this church will set an order to help you, to instruct you, to teach you, to hold your hand from being a disciple to becoming a disciple maker. You're going to disciple somebody this coming year. And it all starts with this congregation. We got a problem if nobody steps forward. I'll just give you that warning right now. We got a problem. We got to rethink our transition in our church. This is a serious decision. If there's no one will speak up next Sunday, we might have to have a business meeting a week or two after that and think about something else different. It's how serious it is. And so there's no guilt here. Just know that you're being asked to make a decision. And just indicate back to us a yes or no. And so if you're willing to be a disciple maker, I'm asking you to step forward at the end of the service next Sunday morning when Walker's done preaching and declare who you are. And we're going to pray for power upon you. We're going to pray God will give you victory in this, that you'll be able to see the fruit of your labors years ahead. And it'll be a wonderful thing if 100 people within 3 miles or 7 miles of this church can be discipled because just a few people said, That's what I want to be. I want to be a part of that. Would you decide? Clock's ticking. 7 days. That's pretty serious, isn't it? You feel like you put on spot? You call me anytime this week? I don't care. I make no apologies for what I've just asked you to do. I feel guilty staying at this church not asking people to be disciple makers. And you're being asked to make your decision. We've been talking about it for weeks now. And next week's our final Sunday. So we can do our planning the days ahead. That's where we're going, our transition. Father, speak to our hearts. I pray that there'll be scores of people that will pray seriously and diligently about whether they want to be included as taking some person that lives within miles of this church, witnessing to them, teaching them continually the gospel of Jesus Christ in a personal way for the glory of Jesus, in whose name I pray. Amen. Let's stand together. Mitch is going to lead us in our closing song.
Thankful that you have Jesus as a friend. Say thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord. Father God, we love you. We love the fact that we can call upon your name, Jesus, and we can call you friend. Lord, you loved us so much that you gave of yourself sacrificially at the cross so that we might have the opportunity to spend life eternally with you. And Lord, that's good news. Help us to share that good news of the friend that we have in Jesus, but more importantly, of the Savior who is Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.